Welcome to Current Issues in American Government. My name is Brenda Riddick, and I am your instructor for this afternoon. I do want to share with you, though, before we get started, that this class is part of the Applied Studies Bachelor's Degree Completion Program. Classes are broadcast live on this cable television channel and then webcast over the internet each week. This fall, we are broadcasting four classes. The first one is Communications 365, which is an introduction to public relations. And that one airs on Tuesday evenings from 7 to 9 p.m. The second one is Labor Studies 412 with a focus on labor law. That one airs on Saturdays from noon to 1:40 p.m. And then this class, which is Political Science 310, Current Issues in American Government, which airs on Saturdays from 1:50 to 3:30 p.m. And the fourth class is Science, Math, and Technology 312, with a focus on natural disasters, which airs on Sundays from noon until 2 p.m. If you have completed the first 2 years of college, you could very well earn your bachelor's degree by enrolling in these classes. All the courses that you need to complete your bachelor's degree will be broadcast on this channel during the next 2 years, and of course, we start the process all over again. If you'd like more information about the Applied Studies Bachelor's Degree Completion Program, just simply give us a call at 1-866-278-6789, or you can go online to www.appliedstudies.tv. Again, thank you for joining us this afternoon. We are going to be talking about civil rights issues with a focus on affirmative action and some of the other things that have gone on in the realm and world of civil rights. We will be joined in our second half hour by a guest. Our guest is the Reverend Eric Lee from the Southern California Leadership Conference, also known as the SCLC, Los Angeles, and he will be joining us for a conversation about inequality, equality, progress from the original goals of affirmative action in education, housing, employment, and areas in that down that avenue. Excuse me. So before we get started, let me just share with you again, that our conversations are focused on civil rights, but I want to introduce affirmative action to you and take you back a minute. What is affirmative action? We've heard some different definitions of affirmative action. We've seen different applications of affirmative action over the years in various levels of government, in various branches of our government, in the workplace, in different areas. Affirmative action means actually taking positive steps to improve the material status of the less advantaged in our society, usually through the provision of educational or economic benefits. Now, some argue that that reality is past, it's all in the past, it's history. We don't need to be concerned about it, we don't need to worry about it. I beg to differ, personally. In the United States, affirmative action usually takes place through the provision of government or private benefits in education, employment, or contracting. Affirmative action is controversial, particularly when the beneficiaries are women or people of color, minorities. In our particular text where we were reading this past week about civil rights and affirmative action in particular, Glenn Lowry from the Anatomy of Racial Inequality, which was published through Harvard University Press back in 2002, says yes on the question about affirmative action. And then Walter Williams from the Affirmative Action Can Be Mended in David Boaz's edition of Toward Liberty, the idea that is changing the world, published by Cato Institute again in 2002, he says no, that we don't really have, affirmative action can't be mended, we can't do anything with it. Lowry sees a clear distinction between racial information and racial identity, which brings up several thought-provoking questions for our conversation today. So students, and those of you watching and listening outside of the classroom, I'd like you to think about these three questions that I'm posing. And for those of you that are watching outside the classroom environment, feel free to give us a call at 1-800-339-1193 with your comments, your questions, your experiences, anything that you'd like to share with us in the area of civil rights and, again, affirmative action. So the three questions I want you to think about are, how does one obtain the former without consciously or unconsciously reinforcing the latter? And what's the value of racial information about a person? What is the value of racial information about a person? You know, we have to fill out forms, we have to put our racial identity, we have to complete the racial identity on employment forms and surveys and the like. That's what Alan is asking generally. And then the third question is, should it be treated any differently from perhaps health information, marital status, income, or any other, sometimes what we perceive or believe or feel as to be sensitive details about the person? So those three questions I want you to contemplate, think about, and we will discuss them in more detail as we work through our conversation today. Affirmative action can be taken in many forms, ranging from very rigid quotas to targeted outreach meant to encourage minorities to apply, but all have in common the effort to increase the number of minorities in educational institutions, in the workplace, and again, receiving contracts if that's the case. But affirmative action programs differ in terms of how much weight they actually give to race as a factor in decision-making and to the extent which they require results. So we'll give you an example of that in just a few minutes. But before I do, I want us to go ahead and take a look at a clip on affirmative action and diversity. And we're going to talk about that word, diversity, throughout the conversation today. These are comments from Dr. James Beatty, and he presents affirmative action and diversity with Dr. E. Sanford and L. Walker, two individuals who have been dealing with the issue of affirmative action and diversity in the workplace for many, many years. So let's take a look at this first clip and then come back at me with your thoughts and comments.
When you talk about the evolution of affirmative action, exactly what are we talking about? Okay. Well, when I talk about this issue on affirmative action, I always like to put it into a historical context. And I think in many instances we have some misconceptions about this affirmative action policy because the general public, even educators and lawyers, have a misconceived notion about the historical backdrop of it. We've come out here in America of 244 years of African enslavement, 81 years of Jim Crow laws, leading into a segregation movement that then led us into the need to have this so-called equal opportunity or a fair opportunity of access. And throughout that first 100 years, I would say around 1640 is quite unusual, but Dr. Kenneth Stamp, in this book entitled The Peculiar Institution, looked at this 1640 as a time when indentured servitude was present here in America. And at that time, in a unique way, they started to look at people of African descent in a different way because of pigmentation. And from that time on, leading into the Dred Scott case of 1857, the Civil War, leading into another landmark Supreme Court decision of 1896 with Plessy versus Ferguson, the main thing is so-called separate and equal, and we all know it was indeed unequal, that then led to one of the shows that you've done in depth, the 1954 Brown versus Board of Education. And it was out of that time period that Reverend Dr. Martin Luther King galvanized the country into this civil rights movement that brought about a lot of change. And with that, people were coming to the table trying to give some thought to how can we give some type of opportunity to those that had historically been denied opportunity.
Okay, and of course, Dr. Sanford, we're getting ready for our first commercial break. Now, Ms. Walker, when we come back, we're going to have about 8 or 10 minutes. And we want you to sort of, within the same context that Dr. Sanford has laid out, to give some statements in reference to affirmative action, and then we'll have an opportunity to talk about how it evolved. And that way we'll be able to sort of pull all this together at the end of our third segment. And we'll be back with our audience following this very, very short commercial break.
Okay, so you heard a little bit of information in that particular clip around affirmative action and the fact that these folks have been dealing with affirmative action at the time that was taken for many, many years, and I'm sure they still are. I shared with you that I would give you an example back on affirmative action programs, how they differ in terms of decision making and to the extent that they actually require some results. An example of that would be the rigid quotas or set-asides that mandate that a certain percentage of beneficiaries be members of designated racial groups and are very different from programs that use race as one factor among many in decision-making. Likewise, there is a significant difference between the government setting targets or goals and the government mandating that there be specific results. Okay? So, there are several justifications that can be made or offered for affirmative action. And because, by definition, affirmative action involves working to assist society's less advantaged members, one reason to promote affirmative action policies is to remedy the effects of what we consider to be past discrimination. So, that's how it came into being. Why did we have to have affirmative action to begin with? And what was the difference between affirmative action and, say, equal opportunity? The remedial justification of affirmative action recognizes that wrongs have been committed in the past and acknowledges a moral obligation to set things right. So, opponents of affirmative action do not contest the actual moral obligation to remedy or remediate past harms from past discrimination. The actual objection to all of this to the remedial policies is frequently centered on the claim that special affirmative action policies will not help those who have, in fact, been harmed, but will sweep too broadly and provide benefits to those who do not actually deserve them. So I ask you, is affirmative action, was affirmative action in the original intent of affirmative action correct in remedying or remediating the wrongs of the past in areas of discrimination and how, for instance, in government, how contracts were awarded and given to individuals who bid for them, whether it be women or minorities, and the fact that many of them didn't get them, government had to put something into place to eventually remedy those discriminatory practices, as well as in housing discrimination, housing discrimination in education, discrimination in employment. Again, sometimes opponents of affirmative action argue that the harm to be remediated didn't actually occur. There was nothing that you needed to fix. There was no problem to begin with. So, if it did occur, as a case of racial discrimination here in the United States, the harm was dissipated so that remedial measures were considered no longer necessary. Another important justification to consider about affirmative action or pro-affirmative action is the so-called diversity rationale. And diversity became a hot word, a hot tagline back in the late 70s, early 80s, as we moved through the civil rights movement and we moved through the Civil Rights Act in the 60s. As we moved forward and progressed trying to minimize issues and erase issues around discrimination, these matters kept coming up. Advocates for the diversity rationale argue that society as a whole benefit when affirmative action is used to maintain diverse schools, workplaces, and businesses. Many people argue that it doesn't work. It didn't work. It shouldn't have been in place to begin with. But according to the argument that I just posed, people from different backgrounds, cultures, and genders bring complementary skills and collectively enrich the places where they work and where they learn. Some affirmative action opponents, however, reject the diversity argument just outright, that there's no place for it, that there is no issue. There didn't need to be anything around creating a level playing field, and that this word diversity should never have come to be. They claim that there is no inherent social benefit to diverse workplaces or schools. Others accept the assertion that diversity is a social benefit, but express doubt over whether racial or gender characteristics actually provide a meaningful basis on which to assess diversity's social benefit. It's the later claim that it's a lot of argument. The later claim is related to what is arguably the most important objection to affirmative action. Before we get into what that one is, I want us to step back for a minute and talk about the American history. In American history, affirmative action conversation, a dinner conversation about affirmative action, reverse discrimination in this particular case, between Derek Vineyard and his father. So let's take a look at it. Come back at me with your thoughts, and we'll move on, and I'll give you the actual argument opposing this.
Yes, definitely.
All right, that's good. 7 o'clock, Billy Horse will be back by. Set it up again.
I'm going to do that.
Behind us.
Oh, hey,
don't laugh. I'm telling you, this guy is different, Dr. Sweeney. It's unbelievable, isn't it? I've never had a teacher like this. He's got like 2 PhDs. I don't know what he's doing teaching in our school. He's not like other teachers. What's the guy you read? We got this essay exam on this book, Native Son. All on the phone book, Native Son. What's that? I don't know that. It's Express. What I read?
I mean, they don't teach time plans in school. Well, they don't.
So what is it? What is this Native Son? What is it? I mean, it's like this book that's black, you know? It's just, we're doing this whole black literature, you know? What is it, Black History Month? No, it's the same. It's SV, you know? It's part of the course now. Yeah. What? And it's just, you know, it's everywhere I look now. What? This affirmative action.
Honey, a few new books doesn't qualify as affirmative black action.
Hey, read the book, Ace the Guy's Test, just on the small, everything, all, you know, just because you see it on the evening news, you know, they're like, what? All this stuff about making everything equal, it's not that simple. Look, now you got this book, Native Son. You know, what happens with the other books in the course? And that ain't good anymore because Mr. 2 PhD says they are? Are you gonna trade in gray books for black books? Does that make sense? Huh? You gotta question these things, Derek. You can't look at the whole picture. You know, we're talking about books here. But I'm also talking about my job. I got 2 black guys on my squad now who got their job over a couple of white guys who actually scored higher in the test. Does that make sense? Huh? Yeah, sure, it's equal now. But I got 2 guys watching my back responsible for my life. Who aren't as good as 2 other guys. You only got the job because they were black. Not because they were the best.
This sucks.
Yeah. Is that what America's about? No, America's about best man for the job. You do your best. Get the job. You know, it's affirmative action crap. I don't know what that's about. Hidden agenda or something going on. See what I'm saying?
Yeah, I do.
I didn't think about it like that. Well, this guy, though. I don't know, Dr. Sweet, he comes on like so strong, it's kind of hard not to listen to him, but I don't know, maybe somebody says it's kind of, it's bullshit. Yeah, maybe. No. It's pure bullshit. You see that, don't you?
Yeah.
You gotta watch out for that.
Yeah, no, I get what you're saying, I will.
Good boy.
How many conversations like that may have taken place in American society, or even globally, worldwide, around this issue of diversity, introduction of affirmative action, equal opportunity, and the like? Just imagine sitting at the dinner table and having a conversation like that. And there were many people, and there still are today, that have those types of conversations. So, hidden agendas. Where are the hidden agendas? What were the hidden agendas, if there were any hidden agendas around the issue of affirmative action and civil rights? Again, the opponents of affirmative action argue that it is wrong to allocate social benefits on the basis of immutable characteristics such as race or gender. For those of you that are watching outside the classroom, just Please feel free to give us a call again at 1-800-329-1193 with your comments and students. So I know some of you are tackling the midterm today, but for those of you that aren't and putting it off until tomorrow or the next couple of days, feel free to send in your emails or your comments as we move through this issue in dialogue. All right, again, opponents of the affirmative action issue argue that there were hidden agendas. They claim that affirmative action is itself a form of racial and or gender discrimination that discriminates against white males, as we saw in that example, in that clip. Contrary to historic forms of discrimination that were actually targeted against women and people of color. So, the charge is often made that affirmative action is, in fact, what we just saw in that clip, reverse discrimination. Supporters of affirmative action argue that the claim that affirmative action is discriminatory is overly formalistic. Although admitting that affirmative action does discriminate in a technical sense, supporters claim affirmative action is morally justified when its goal is not to harm the white majority, but to provide social justice for those who have been deprived of opportunities in the past. So, we want to step back for a minute and talk about the origins of affirmative action. And before I get there, or as I introduce that, we're also going to talk about 1964, the Civil Rights Act of 1964. So, the origins of affirmative action, the concepts of affirmative action can be traced back to efforts after the Civil War to remedy the devastating effects of slavery. Government efforts such as the creation of the Freedmen's Bureau unquestionably were forms of affirmative action in that they provided benefits to racial minorities. The term affirmative action apparently was first used in the National Labor Relations Act and was adopted in 1935, so it goes way back. It's not something that's just happened as a result of the Civil Rights Movement, but it was moved and progressed in that direction as a result of what was going on in the 50s and 60s. The context was not race, but rather the affirmative duty of employers to remedy discrimination, in this case against union members and union organizers. Employers found to have engaged in such discrimination were required to remedy this by taking steps to ensure that the employers were in the same position in which they would have been had there been no discrimination in the first place. The term was first used in the race context by President John F. Kennedy, and in 1961, 3 years prior to the enactment of the first major post-Reconstruction Civil Rights Law, President Kennedy then issued an executive order preventing race discrimination by federal agencies. So we know this was going on before that time. We have some background history and knowledge about what was happening with minorities and women in the workplace and, again, in contracts and in education. All right. I see there's a comment from Alan. I was talking with another applicant for a senior management job, and the position went to the diversity candidate, not me. I accept and appreciate the decision they made. It stung at the time, but promoting diversity is worth the individual. It was worth the individual hits we all may take. Thank you, Alan, for your comment. Gerardo says, I was hired by an employer based on extra points I received for being a minority. This made me feel unequal, as though I wasn't good enough to get hired based on my own qualifications. Thank you, Gerardo. So, do you think, Gerardo, that it should have been, that there was a place and time for affirmative action and that it should have taken place? Was there, there was apparently an opportunity, based on what you shared with us, to be bumped up based on the points that you were given? And from what I'm hearing you saying or sharing, that should have, your qualifications and your merit is what should have been used to determine whether or not you qualified for that particular job, and not the implications of equal opportunity or affirmative action. Well, in that case, it should have been equal opportunity, but we're talking about affirmative action. Maria says, affirmative action, loses value when rigidly enforced. Okay, she says, affirmative action loses value when rigidly enforced. I would not want to get a job only because I am a minority. There is also the perceived view that minorities cannot supervise whites. Thank you, Maria, for your comments. And that is an underlying issue, and a lot of people have the opinion that we have the color thing. You know, you're not better than me, or you're not worse than me. I don't want you supervising me. I don't want you telling me what to do. We have those situations in the workplace. We also have them again in housing and education. How do we get over that? How do we go from point A to point B? That's why these programs were put into place. Did they serve us the way that they were intended to serve us? Some would argue that they didn't. Some would argue that they did. My oldest daughter went to Cal Berkeley up north, and many people asked her. She received her undergraduate degree at Cal Berkeley. Many people asked her back at the time when she went to school. They told her that she went to school. They still talk about it today, that there's an underlying assumption that she was part of the affirmative action program through the UC system to get her in. Never mind that she had a 3.9 grade point average, that she was an athlete as well. She didn't go to school on an athletic scholarship. We paid for her education. She had great essays. She had everything that she needed to qualify to be a UC applicant and accepted at UC as well as other schools she was accepted for in California as well as outside of California. To this day, as a principal at her school, her elementary school in the Bay Area, when she meets new people, and they ask her what schools she went to. She went to UC Berkeley for her undergrad. She went to Ohio State for her first graduate degree. Then she went back and got a second graduate degree. She went on to earn a teaching credential, an administrative credential, and is now pursuing her doctorate degree. Again, the beginning steps of those when she went to school back in the early 90s, late 80s, early 90s, was that the assumption was that she actually benefited from the extra points or whatever it was that was added to applications through the UC system. No, she didn't get in that way. She got in on her own merit. And the same thing for my other daughter who went to UC Davis. No, she got in on her academic and athletic merit. The work that she did in the community and all those other attributes that were a part of that application and screening process, not because of affirmative action. Was there something wrong with that? There is something wrong with it when people assume and take the hidden agenda part of that and use it against you, that you aren't good enough to get in on your own. So I particularly have an issue with it in that sense. But we'll move on. Vincent says, I believe these ethnic questioners do not provide diversity, rather segregation. Okay, these ethnic questioners do not provide diversity, rather segregation. The information is used to categorize humans, and it affects all ethnic backgrounds and has no place in society. So, again, one would ask, why do we collect the information? Why do we need it? Why is it something that's on the census forms every year? Why is it on every application? Why does the government keep data, statistical data information about areas like that? Diversity. Why do they need to know gender? Why do they need to know race? Why do they need to know age? Why do they need to know income? It's government. The government has that information and they need it. Does it produce results like what was shared with us, what Vince was shared with us, that it segregates people and puts them into boxes? Yes, it does. Is the intent for segregation? No. Is it? Does it categorize us by who's in the United States, who's in our world? Sure it does. Is that what the actual intent is? Marcus says, is affirmative action really required? Do you mean to tell me that a qualified female or minority applicant could not be found? More emphasis should be placed on equal opportunities. Is affirmative action really required? So that's one of the questions. And the other question is, aren't there enough qualified individuals or minority applicants around that affirmative action would not have had to have taken place? Marcus, when you think about what happened in the past and how minorities and women were discriminated in, again, education, in housing, in employment, in government contracts for minorities, something needed to be put in place from the government by law to ensure that blatant or subtle discrimination did not continue to occur. And while there were many qualified individuals who could fill the jobs, many of them were discouraged from doing so or told that they didn't meet the qualifications when, in fact, they did. Samuel says, in France, they don't keep track of race and gender, so they say they do not have a problem with racism because they don't keep track of racism. Do you think that's true? I don't know if they keep track of what statistical information they keep track of on race and gender, but I'm not sure that I could agree with you that there is no particular issue of race in France or in any particular country. So Samuel, go out there and explore that on France a little bit more and come back and let me know. All right, the context of what President Kennedy put into place, the executive order, 1961, he mandated affirmative action to ensure that applicants are employed and that employees are treated during employment without regard to race, color, creed, or national origin. And then President Lincoln extended the policy, though without using the actual phrase of affirmative action, when he issued the executive order 11,246 during his time in office, demanding that all executive departments and agencies shall establish and maintain a positive program of equal employment opportunity. And then in 1964 Civil Rights Act implemented this prohibition of race discrimination by statute. And the act prohibited places of public accommodation, such as restaurants or hotels, from being discriminating based on race. So there were a lot of times when we had celebrities back in the day who performed for the general public, but were not allowed to stay in hotels or in places of business where it was deemed whites only. And so that helped in that situation to eliminate discrimination for places of business and hotels in that situation. Then we had another portion of it titled Prohibited Employers from Discriminating on the Basis of Race, Gender, or Religion, Title VII. The act did not speak directly against affirmative action, but did prohibit discrimination and open the door to claims that affirmative action actually was essential to meet the statutory prohibition against discrimination in total. It was quickly realized that prohibiting discrimination just is not enough to achieve equality. And we have, and we've talked about this before, significant inequality in our society. We have inequality in all areas, not just in education, but also in housing, again, in the employment sector, in health. We have a lot of inequality in our society. Positive steps, though, toward remedying the legacy of discrimination and enhancing diversity are essential. Many believe are essential. So affirmative action programs of all sorts began to proliferate and really flourish back in the 1970s. So again, around the Civil Rights Act of 1964, it did prohibit discrimination against persons on the basis of race, color, national origin, or religion, and gender. And then the act established the right to equal opportunity in employment, period. A basic problem remained, however, that minority groups and women, because of past discrimination, often lacked the education and or skills to compete effectively in the marketplace. So remember, Marcus asked if they find any qualified women or minorities to fill some of those jobs. So one of the hindrances to that effort, Marcus, was the fact that women were not, minorities and women were not readily, education was not readily available to them to pursue the skill sets that they needed to compete at the levels of their counterparts who were getting those jobs. All right, and then in 1965, the federal government attempted to remedy this again through the concept of what we've been talking about, which is affirmative action. So we're going to take a step back for a minute and look at news coverage from how affirmative action has affected not just women and minorities, but the gay and lesbian community as well. We're going to get into some conversation around Prop 8, and you'll see a couple clips around that in a few minutes, but let's look at how affirmative action or this issue around the Civil Rights Act has changed society in some ways. In this particular clip, this is an NBC News footage on the murders of San Francisco Mayor George Moscone and Supervisor Harvey Milk. The footage covers suspect Dan White's arrest and a brief history of everyone. So let's take a look at it, come back at me, and give me your thoughts. This is going down a different direction as in regard to the Civil Rights Act of 1964 and what its intent was for coverage and then around, again, gays and lesbians and protection and equal opportunity and equal rights for everyone. Okay, before you guys go there, broadcast room. Let's look at the Civil Rights Movement. Number three, the brief history about the Civil Rights Movement. Sorry about that.
The Civil Rights Movement took place around the 1950s and 1960s. This time period was marked by racial segregation in the community and prejudices against African Americans. Everything, including schools, restaurants, bus seats, bathrooms, and even drinking fountains, were segregated into white and color. A landmark case for the movement was the Supreme Court case of Brown versus the Board of Education in 1954. Linda Brown was denied admission to her elementary school in Topeka, Kansas, because she was black. A lawsuit was filed against the Board of Education. Her suit eventually reached the Supreme Court under Chief Justice Earl Warren. Attorney Thurgood Marshall of the National Association for the Advancement of Colored People argued that the segregation among schools was not giving equal opportunities to the minorities. Warren ruled that separate educational facilities are inherently unequal and is therefore unconstitutional. From that point on, the schools of Topeka, Kansas were desegregated, much to the dismay of the white majority. This court decision became the first step towards African-American civil rights. In Montgomery, Alabama, on December 1, 1955, the monumental bus boycott was ignited by Rosa Parks when she refused to move to the back of the bus to give up her seat to a white man. She, along with Martin Luther King Jr., led the boycott. It lasted for more than a year until the buses were desegregated on December 21st, 1956. Many nonviolent protests popped up around this time, such as the Greensboro Sit-in. In February of 1960, four African-American students from North Carolina Agricultural and Technical College sat at a segregated Woolworth's lunch counter. Even though they were refused service, they were allowed to sit at the counter. This triggered many similar student sit-ins throughout the South and was very effective. 6 months later, the four students were served lunch at the same Woolworth's counter. This method of protest was used to desegregate other public places, such as swimming pools, public parks, libraries, and theaters. As time passed, tensions grew. Public protests were becoming more frequent. The police started arresting and jailing protesters. Eventually, violence arose. Policemen used fire hoses and police dogs to suppress protests. Martin Luther King Jr., influenced by Mohandas Gandhi's methods of nonviolent protest, led the March on Washington on August 28, 1963. He and 250,000 supporters marched from the Washington Monument to the Lincoln Memorial, where King gave his famous I Have a Dream speech.
One day live in a nation where they will not be judged by the color of their skin, but by the content of their character. I have a dream.
The march and speech were broadcast on national and international television. Literally hundreds of cameramen were used to cover the event. Television stations around the world, from ABC to BBC, gave some of their own commentaries on the event to give their local audiences a thorough understanding of it. Finally, on July 2, 1964, Lyndon B. Johnson signed the Civil Rights Act, the most sweeping civil rights legislation since Reconstruction. The act made racial discrimination illegal. public places, such as libraries and parks, were desegregated. Schools and employers were forced to give equal opportunities to everyone, regardless of skin color. Unfortunately, not everyone was happy about the integration of blacks and whites in society. On June 21, 1964, three civil rights workers, James Cheney, Andrew Goodwin, and Michael Schwerner, who had been working to register black voters in Mississippi, were murdered. Policemen had arrested them for speeding, kept them imprisoned for hours, and then released them after dark for the Ku Klux Klan to kill. It was later proven that a conspiracy existed between the county's law enforcement and the Ku Klux Klan. It is clear that even with the success of the Civil Rights Movement and the signing of the Civil Rights Act of 1964, we still do have social inequalities and injustices, even to this day. Despite the existence of such groups like the KKK, the Civil Rights Movement did have a profound impact on the attitudes of the rest of the world regarding civil rights. It served as a model for the support and advancement of other minority groups, such as women, disabled, homosexuals, and many others. Awareness for these minorities brought about the establishment of organizations advocating their rights. Examples of these groups include the Beijing Platform for Action, the Optional Protocol to the International Covenant on Civil and Political Rights, the Black Power Movement, and the Advancement in Gender Equality. Today, civil rights are granted to all American citizens. Voting rights are not affected by race or gender, and public discrimination is less prevalent. The civil rights movement has opened the door to new possibilities.
Okay, so you have there a brief history and a little bit of background again on what happened with civil rights and how we got to affirmative action, equal opportunity, and the Civil Rights Act of 1964. With the civil rights movement. And I know when I talk to my students about civil rights, particularly around the civil rights movement of the 50s and the 60s, and again it was the 70s, even though we had a law in the 60s that outlawed discrimination, some of them ask, why do we need to know that now? Why do we have to go backwards on something that we didn't see, we weren't there, we are not part of? Why do we need to know that to move forward? And I tell them, you do need to know your history. You do need to know from where it started to where it is today to where it's going tomorrow. And that you're a part of what's happening today and a part of what could be tomorrow. So you should have some foundation, understanding, and background about where you've come from or where you've been in society, where society has been, to get where we want to go progressively in the right direction. Melissa says, I feel it is very difficult to change one's status in society, even with education. If one does not have connections, it's extremely hard to get a job or get promoted. How do we combat that? Those are good questions, Melissa, or actually it's a good statement, Melissa, and a good question. How do you, even with education, it is difficult, and I mean, look at what's going on with our economy today and the unemployment rate here in California, as well as some of the other states that are as high as we are. How do you get to where you want to be without assistance in some way or another or having that connection or networking? And I would say that networking is definitely a benefit. But how do you get there on your own merit? You have to combine a couple of things. Sometimes people say you have to be in the right place at the right time. You have to have things put in place so that you, if you do meet the qualifications, you are not just tossed aside as what was happening in the past, that you have an equal opportunity to compete for the same job, the same house, the same health plan, the same health care, the same physicians, the same hospital, as anyone else who also meets those standards and qualifications. Eventually, it says, recent history teaches us that our government has had racially motivated agendas, and we must protect all citizens with these laws, such as affirmative action. He suggests that perhaps we need new legislation. And good point, Nancy. And perhaps we do need new legislation. The legislation that was put in place in 1964 and has consequently been extended, does that meet our current day needs? Should we go back and look at something to change what's happening in our environment and world today? What is happening in our current environment and world today? What issues do you think that are happening in the area of civil rights that perhaps we need to readdress or initially address that could possibly change something that was already put in place from the current laws or something else that needs to be put in place to protect us differently? Maria says, I think a lot of today's needs are due to past perceived views. For instance, she says, my parents did not believe in education for women. She says, sometimes discrimination comes from within our own culture. Good point, Maria, and I would have to agree with you. There are many cultures that education is not perceived as being or valued as being necessary for women once they reach a certain grade. There are cultures that after you get out of high school, why do you need to work? Go get a job. I mean, why do you need to go to school? Go get a job. That it may not be that culture's value that women have a higher education. I know in some cultures, if you do want to get a higher education, and it may or may not threaten the male in that in a particular relationship, or it may threaten the male in a given family. Yes, there are cultural issues around that. Do we set ourselves up for these types of issues? Are they internal to our family setting? Are they internal to our community, to our culture, even to our religion? I ask you guys. Good time, Maria. Thank you. All right. An argument opposing affirmative action says that the Constitution, maybe, again, where Vincent was saying we probably need to go back and revisit and look at perhaps some new legislation. Those who are opposed to affirmative action argue that the Constitution requires that government treat each person, as he said, as an individual without regard for his or her race. So, again, are we not doing that? Did we not do that to begin with? No, we didn't do that to begin with. Yes, the Constitution says that, but we did not do what the Constitution says. Justice Sandra Day O'Connor stated in one of her briefs, classifications based in race carry a danger of stigmatic harm. Unless they are strictly reserved for remedial settings, they may in fact promote notions of racial inferiority and lead to politics of racial hostility, end quote. However, on the other side of this particular debate, supporters of affirmative action argue that there is, in fact, significant difference between the government's use, and we talked about classifications before, between the government's use of racial classifications to benefit minorities and government's use of racial classifications to disadvantage minorities. There's been a long history of racism and discrimination against minorities, but no similar history of persecution of whites. Is that a true statement? Is that something that you guys agree with or disagree with? Those in favor of affirmative action point to the tremendous continuing disparities between blacks and whites, again, in such areas as education, employment, and public contracting as necessitating remedial action. Now, we've come a long way, we've regressed a long way, some people would say, from what was occurring back in the 50s and the 60s and even early 70s to where we are today. You may not see or feel or hear the effects of discrimination in the workplace, in your immediate environment, in your sphere of influence with people around you. So it doesn't exist. It's still there. Do we need to have something like affirmative action or equal opportunity or anything else available to, again, create a level balance, a level playing field to balance out the things that are occurring or maybe not occurring in society? Supporters also argue that there is a major difference between a majority discriminating against a minority and a majority discriminating against itself. And John Mark Eli explains in an article back in 1974, when the group that controls the decision-making process classifies so as to advantage a minority and disadvantage itself, the reasons for being unusually suspicious and consequently employing a stringent brand of review are lacking. A white majority is unlikely to disadvantage itself for reasons of racial prejudice, nor is it likely to be tempted either to underestimate the needs and deserts of whites relative to those of others or to overstate will estimate the cost of devising an alternative classification that would extend to certain whites, the disadvantages generally extended to blacks. So that was an assessment made by John Hart Eli in an article in 1974 as he explained his view on the situation. All right, in this next clip now, we're going to take this avenue that I shared with you. We're going to go down about civil rights and gays and lesbians. We're going to look at what happened with George Moscone and Harvey White and the situation that created so much chaos in San Francisco back in the 70s. Take a look at it and come back in with your comments.
This is NBC Nightly News with John Chancellor in New York, David Bentley in Washington, and tonight's Cipher 3, Ryan Ross' report on the migrant worker.
Good evening. George Moscone, the mayor of San Francisco, was shot dead in his office in City Hall this morning. So was Harvey Milk, a city supervisor. Both shot, both murdered. Apparently, there was no connection here with the Jim Jones cult, which is based in San Francisco. The police arrested Dan White, a one-time city supervisor who had resigned and wanted Moscone to reappoint him, but he had not agreed to do so. Here's Rick Davis in San Francisco.
This senior K. Flowers was on the steps of City Hall. He was placed under the mayor's window just a few months after the death of Mayor George Moscone. The flags were half-staff moments later as the city learned that the mayor and its supervisor, Harvey Milk, had been murdered. When word of the deaths first came down, first thoughts were of the People's Temple story. Reports that there was an assassination squad with a hit list naming city politicians. But it was not that. It was city politics gone mad.
This is former supervisor Dan White a few weeks ago on the day he resigned from office, saying the job didn't pay enough to support his family. Later, White changed his mind and wanted his job back. Mayor Moscone was about to appoint someone else today. Dan White was a former police officer and fireman. Today at 11 a.m., he went to City Hall, to the office of the mayor, and shot and killed him, according to witnesses. This was George Moscone last Wednesday, weeping at the funeral of his close friend, Congressman Leo Ryan, killed in Guyana. Now this city weeps for George Moscone. This is the body of Supervisor Harvey Milk that was taken from City Hall. Witnesses say after killing the mayor, Milk ran down the hall and fired three shots at Milk, killing him. Milk had opposed the reappointment of White. In full confusion after the shooting, President of the Board of Supervisors, Diane Feinstein, spoke.
Both Mayor Moscone and Supervisor Harvey Milk have been shot. A suspect is
There are those who spoke of the charm and youthful ability of Dan White. There were many who thought someday he could have been mayor of this city. Rick Davis, NBC News, San Francisco.
He was a shock. San Franciscans who live in a beautiful city noted for his lively and often unorthodox politicians. Jack Perkins has more on this.
George Moscone was a Navy veteran, a bright young lawyer, who got into politics 15 years ago. First, as one of the youngest members ever of the San Francisco Board of Supervisors, then a state senator, an extremely active and productive state senator. From this base, 3 years ago, he ran for and was elected mayor of San Francisco. It was a narrow victory, only 2% of the victory nonetheless. Democratic Party bosses were ecstatic. George Moscone wept with joy that night. As mayor, he felt his strength was the politician's ability to balance divergent elements, to settle a thorny strike of municipal workers, to keep the town's baseball team, the Giants, from leaving San Francisco. As mayor, he made one ill-fated appointment. The Reverend Jim Jones, appointed to the city's housing authority by Mayor Moscone.
I appointed somebody who had a reputation as a peacemaker in this city, who had worked with poor people and people in frustration. His reputation was that you do not resort to violent means. You deal with reason and persuasion.
This was the other victim today, the man in the suit, Harvey Milk, the most unorthodox politician, a homosexual, elected not in spite of it, but because of it, in a district that is largely homosexual. As a member of the Board of Supervisors, Harvey Milk championed homosexual rights.
So I gave you just a brief history about what happened with Mayor Moscone and Harvey Milk. And the death that was inflicted upon them by Dan White, who was not happy with the reappointment of Harvey Milk in San Francisco by Moscone. Again, equal rights, equal opportunity, civil rights. What did we miss in that situation? That was back in 1978. Where are we today? What have we missed between 78 and today? Again, for equal rights for all. We talked about affirmative action over the last 45 minutes or so, and we'll continue to talk about it. But where are the equal rights and affirmative action and civil rights for all individuals? Susan says, I think that the idea of the general welfare of the common good and the Constitution is a principle that we should fight for. The greatest thing about America is that we get better. So let's get better. Thank you, Samuel, for your comment. Mike says, the civil rights movement was one step towards societal evolution. The natural tendency is to hold back the less powerful from those who hold the power. Affirmative action was needed to get the ball rolling, but when polls resulted, it took a wrong turn toward reverse discrimination. So thank you, Mike, for your comment. Penny says, I think race information is handled sensitively today, but necessary information to collect to make sure that underrepresented minorities and women are able to participate in schooling or other programs. Thank you, Penny, for your comment. You guys have had some good comments and some good opinions expressed this afternoon. Keep them coming. I do have another clip I want to share with you again on the in the area of what's going on with our gay and lesbian community around equal rights, civil rights. People deem this as being the civil rights issue of the 21st century, ensuring that everyone had the same opportunity, the same civil rights afforded them as humans to do the things that they wanted to do. We've seen with the proposition that was defeated in 2008, that did not allow for that to happen. We've seen some reversals on that in the courts. We've seen some holdups with judges' decisions, recent. So when we come back from break, we're going to take a break in a few minutes. Before we go to break, though, I want to share another video clip with you around this particular issue. And then when we come back, we're going to have our guest speaker with us, the Reverend Eric Lee. And we're going to talk a little bit more around what's going on in society from his perspective on these particular issues that we've talked about today. So the clip that I want to share with you is around, I think I shared that if we were to look at the gay and lesbian community, so if we could, back room, if we could switch over to the View and Prop 8, gay marriage ban passes, gay adoption ban, the View discusses the topics of gay marriage and gay adoption. And then we'll come back. Good. Thank you.
Surprises yesterday. You know, one of the things that we want to let you know is that Al Franken seems to have lost in Minister Thielen, but he is not ready to concede because he wants to make sure that all of the votes are counted before he says a concession speech.
He's separated by less than 600 votes.
Yeah.
So that's up to her, you know?
Yeah. So he wants to make sure.
That's a chuckle, Sal.
You always have to wonder if it hurts more to lose by a little bit or a lot.
I'd rather lose by a lot because that would annoy me.
Because you think, okay, I'll go home, I'll start the casserole, then you get a phone call, oh, by the way, they elected you. You know, so you don't want to concede too early.
So close.
You need to count. But here's also what has been going on in the rest of the country. Now, California had initiative Prop 8, which was a measure to ban gay marriage in all its rights. It's still undecided, apparently. Momentum seems to be...
It means that they haven't counted all the votes.
Yes.
No, but it's leaning towards a ban.
Yes.
So the people who got married, does that mean they're no longer married, or does that mean the people who got married before was recognized?
I don't know if it's retroactive in terms of...
Well, it was in San Francisco, wasn't it?
Didn't the generous get married?
Yeah.
Yes. And what this means is, you know, people say, why not civil unions? Here's the reason gay folks wanted the Marriage Act. Because in a civil union, if Elizabeth and I go into our golden years, and I pass away first, and my second cousin on my mother's side, Sherry, sees the property that I have, she can come in and say to Elizabeth, it's mine.
Even though you have a...
In a marriage, if Elizabeth and I were married, we have two kids. Whatever was mine as the husband or the wife would normally go to Elizabeth.
If you are partners and one of you has a baby, the other one is not automatically the parent, whereas if you're married, and there are cases where you have to adopt the other person's child, which is, I'm reading, Arkansas passed a measure to stop homosexuals from adopting kids. They passed a measure so that homosexuals cannot adopt kids.
Is it just go for Obama?
Extraordinary. All the children who are out there who need to be adopted, you know, not everybody can do it. And why would you put a ban on people who want to adopt children, will take the children no one else wants? Why would you put a break on that?
There are a lot of heterosexuals out there that are bad parents. So to be able to make a statement like that, I don't know.
I shout out to Michigan, who voted to allow medical use of marijuana.
Yes.
There should be more applause for that.
We're all feeling a little ill right now.
Florida and Arizona both banned same-sex marriage.
No, they didn't. Now, I'm just thinking with all this information, state by state, I mean, people could essentially say, I'm going to move here, I'm going to go here. This could affect real estate.
Well, I'm definitely going to be stopping in Michigan.
Well, look, but I'm looking at Nebraska. I wanted to say, Nebraska voted to end affirmative action to help minorities. And, you know, a lot of people, you said this before, think it's just black people. But a lot of this is women there's some people who just need a leg up, a little helping hand, a little bit of a lift, and now they've stopped.
What's interesting is affirmative action became a bad word several years ago because it became this catchword for people who are getting something they don't deserve. And oftentimes people forget the root of what it was. Now, if we lived in the country that we always pray that we're going to wake up in, where everything works and everybody's equal, you wouldn't need affirmative action. But sometimes you have to say to governments and to people, look, you need to make sure this happens. You have the capacity to do that. So it's very sad that Nebraska voted to end affirmative action to help minorities, because women are minorities. Children with special needs are minorities. There are a lot of minorities that you just cut out.
40% of this country now, 40% are minorities. That's a huge number.
We're not going to make any kind of special help.
Well, the minority will soon become the majority.
The majority will soon become the majority.
Don't worry about it. In Washington, the state of Washington voted to allow doctor-assisted suicide. So controversial.
Yeah. Well, I'd be visiting them, too.
Yeah. I'm great. If we do it together, do we get a contract?
You could even take a speed train.
Yeah.
All right, so you heard the conversation on The View around that situation. They talked about the Nebraska, the state of Nebraska, eliminating or abolishing affirmative action in that state. And, you know, our manifestation of the political and social debate in this area, that the initiatives that have been adopted across the country limiting affirmative action. Just keep in mind that in 1996, California voters passed Proposition 209, the so-called California Civil Rights Initiative. The initiative amended the state constitution to bar discrimination or preferences on the basis of race, again, in government contracting, education, or employment. And then a similar initiative was adopted almost simultaneously in Washington State. In November 2006, Michigan voters passed Proposition 2, which was almost identical to the California Proposition 209, banning discrimination or preferences based on race. And then just keep in mind that these initiatives reflect the public's disapproval of affirmative action. So the rhetoric that the government should be colorblind is appealing, allows for people to limit or eliminate affirmative action while feeling noble. On the other hand, those who believe that affirmative action is essential to remedy past discrimination and achieve diversity have had a hard time overcoming the impression that such programs are actually reverse discrimination. So where does the future of affirmative action go? Where is the future of our civil rights? We'll talk about it in a few minutes when we bring our guest in, Reverend Eric Lee. And I want you guys to go ahead and take a 5-minute break. As we move into our second part of this afternoon, and when you come back, we'll have our interview with Reverend Lee. Thank you.
You are watching DHTV, television program service of California State University, Dominguez Hills.
Bienvenidos! Welcome, everyone, to this very historic moment for Cal State University Dominguez Hills' EMVAL Manifest Destiny. As we celebrate this magnificent work of art, what we're celebrating is the richness of our community, the richness of our university, the richness of all of the people that come to California State University Dominguez Hills, and the leaders that helped us be where we are today. It brings to light one of the one important asset that I say is what makes us so special, the multi-ethnicity of our institution. As we celebrate our 50th anniversary, these are really historic moments. They are our points of pride that will last a lifetime. And I thank all of you for all of your work and dedication. Thank you so very much.
Hi, I'm Tiffany from Cal State Dominguez Hills Athletics, and welcome to the Toros Coaches Corner. Please welcome the head coach for men's basketball program, Damon Cal. Hi, Coach.
Yeah.
I'm good. How are you doing?
Good. Nice to
be here. Yeah, welcome. We enjoyed a great season despite having just 4 returning players. Tell us what the team learned from that experience and what we can look forward to this year.
I think the thing that our team learned from that experience was how to stick together. I think the most part of the team is even we're going through a hard time, the fact that we're there.
Is this the year we regain our position as one of the elite teams in the conference?
I think so. The last few years, people regard us as one of the elite teams, and we're going to be up there again.
And what can people expect to see when they come to watch the Toros this season?
Well, like every year, I hope the fans that you've seen, the team play hard, the team play passionate, and we don't know what you're going to hear every game, but only that I hope that people keep on watching, we play hard, we defeat it, we play the right way, we're respectful, and we represent the university well. So that's why it's always my goals every year.
Well, Coach, we thank you for joining us on this edition of the Toros Coaches Corner. And until we see you in this morning, remember to make every day your masterpiece. So, go Toros.
Go Toros.
Hi, my name is Monique McNeil. I'm currently attending California State University Dominguez Hills from West Los Angeles College. I chose Dominguez Hills because I heard about the great facility and the great people.
Come on, nice paper.
Program service of California State University for Minnesota.
All right, welcome back, students. Let me just remind you that this class is part of the Applied Studies Bachelor's Degree Completion Program. And classes are broadcast live on this cable television channel each and every week, as well as over the internet. This class, this fall, will be broadcast in four classes. The Political Science 310 Current Issues in American Government is one of them, which is my class. And that one airs on Saturdays from 1:50 to 3:30 p.m. The second one will be Communications 365 with a focus on public relations, and that class airs on Tuesdays from 7 to 9 p.m. The third class is Labor Studies 412 with a focus on labor law, and that one airs on Saturdays from 1:40 until 1:40, just before my class. And then the fourth one is Science, Math, and Technology 312 with a focus on natural disasters. That one airs on Sundays from noon until 2 p.m. If you have, in fact, completed the first 2 years of your bachelor's degree, for 2 years of college, you can earn your bachelor's degree by enrolling in these classes. All of the courses that you need to complete your bachelor's degree will be broadcast on this channel during the next 2 years, and then, you know, we start the process all over again. If you'd like more information about the Applied Studies Bachelor's Degree Completion Program, just give us a call at 1-866-278-6789 or go online to www.appliedstudies.tv. All right, so you had a quick 5-minute break. Before you went to break, you were talking about affirmative action, civil rights. I promised you we'd have a guest with us when we returned. And so our guest has joined us, and I'm pleased to welcome Reverend Eric P. Lee, who is President and CEO of the Southern Christian Leadership Conference here in Los Angeles, also known as SCLC. And I'm just going to give a little bit of background about Reverend Lee. As a child, Reverend Lee was inspired by Dr. Martin Luther King, Jr., and his guiding principle, injustice anywhere is a threat to justice everywhere. He has committed himself to fighting injustice in all of these forms, striving for equality, freedom, and justice for all people. Reverend Lee, who supports marriage equality and LGBT rights, opposed the California Ballot Initiative Proposition 8. He is author of the book, Marriage Equality, Proposition 8, The California Divide. Reverend Lee has stated that education may be the primary civil rights issue of our generation and written extensively about this concern. He is co-producer of Who Is Accountable, a 90-minute documentary on the failure of public education for both African-American and Latino children. Reverend Eric Lee is a founding member of the Stand for Security Coalition, which fought to organize African-American security officers into the SEIU Union, a member of the Diversity Task Force, working to reintegrate African-Americans into the hotel and restaurant industries through the union to unite here,
founding member of the Alliance for Equal Opportunity in Education, a founding member of the Knowledge Transfer Summit, an African American Leadership Forum, that's what the Knowledge Transfer Summit is, and a founding member and chair of the Black Education Task Force, which is a collaboration of organizations striving to improve the quality of education for Black students in the Los Angeles Unified School District, and a vice member of the New Frontier Democratic Club. Reverend Lee has a bachelor's degree from UC Berkeley and a master's degree in pastoral studies from Azusa Pacific College University, and is a candidate for a master's degree in divinity, also from Azusa Pacific University. Reverend Lee is affiliated with the Black Business Association, Recycling Black Dollars, and the 100 Black Men of Los Angeles, as well as Kappa Alpha Psi, or Pi, fraternity. Reverend Lee has been married 17 years and has 3 children. The Liberty Hill Foundation at www.libertyhill.org calls Reverend Lee one of the 2010 grassroots leaders to watch. And so I'm very proud and pleased to have him join us this afternoon and appreciate him taking the time out of his very busy day and weekend, I'm sure, to be with us. Students, again, I encourage you to send your comments as I ask questions. You may also. Thank you. Welcome.
Thank you. I'm glad to be here.
Good. Can you please tell us what the Southern Christian Leadership Conference of Greater Los Angeles is and the nature of your work with the organization?
The Southern Christian Leadership Conference, or SCLC, as an acronym states, is not a teams organization, which essentially is formed in 1957. And then proceeded to establish chapters throughout the United States. We are the largest chapter in the United States and continue to work the legacy of Dr. King and advocating for civil rights for those that are marginalized, oppressed, and disenfranchised because of the institutional discrimination, racism that continues to exist in our society. And so we focus on education reform. Is one of our key focus areas. As you know, since the 1954 Brown v. Board of Education Supreme Court decision, the achievement gap has not closed between African Americans and Asian students. And so we're looking at how we can improve the quality of education so that all children receive an equal quality of education. We also look now recently at the LGBT equality. Affirmative mix of the top 8 issue for marriage equality. The simple question is this: do I believe gay and lesbian couples deserve the right to be married? Is that a civil rights issue? And I said, you see, every time one group of people are denied the same rights as the rest of society, then you are fundamentally denying them the rights, and I believe that to be an issue. And it's the third issue that SCLC focuses on is identifying, training, and empowering the next generation of political leaders into a political system.
Very good. Okay, so as soon as you have an introduction of what Reverend Lee's organization is about here in Los Angeles, and again, I encourage you to send in your comments as we have this dialogue. And I shared with you while we were waiting to come online that I saw the movie Waiting for Superman, and I'm very impressed with the information, and I'm ignoring myself coming up through the schools in Compton. Having grown up in this community here, I understand the inequality of education dating all the way back to when I was in school back in the day. You know, I did my junior high school and high school years here. Elementary was overseas in Germany. When I was in Germany, I didn't know that I was this color. I didn't know that this made a difference until we relocated to the United States and was told and found out during 1965 when we returned from Germany and settled in Wilmington and San Pedro. But this made a difference, and the Watts riots broke out, and I quickly found out that it mattered that I was not like everybody else according to my skin tone. It didn't matter how much I understood or knew or how I was educated and what I learned overseas or anything else. The inequality of education that we have, the huge achievement gap, is significant, and it keeps growing. Having watched Waiting for Superman, what is it that your organization along the lines of managing that inequality and shrinking that gap. What do you think you're doing to help with that?
Well, as you know, there's a huge reform effort going across the nation regarding our public school system.
Right.
And Waiting for Superman gives a snapshot view on one of the challenges that we face in providing a quality education to children of color. It's just that many people will criticize Waiting for Superman because it looks singularly at the unions as being the main obstacle to reforming education. There are many variables to why we don't have a quality education environment in our communities. But what it does do is follow the plight of four or five families seeking to give their children access to quality education, oftentimes outside of their community, and the chance that they find in order to acquire that quality education. A lot of it is through the charter school movement. And so children are given the hope for the future on getting into a charter school. And the devastation is when, through a lottery process, where they choose 2% of the school population to go into a charter school, sometimes less than that. The devastation when you don't get in is heartbreaking. And so it effectively plays on one's emotions about the desire for every family, every parent, regardless of their economic status, to give their children a quality education. But I think it does narrowly look at the unions as the culprit in hindering that education from coming forth. Now, there's some issues
here. Absolutely.
There are some issues. And I think what's happened is that there has been an imbalanced, unfair burden borne by the teachers.
Mm-hmm.
Okay? Because the teachers, I think, with all good intent and motivation, go into a system that is broken.
Right.
It's not to fix the system.
Right.
It's easy to point the fingers at a teacher because they are the most critical component in a quality education. But if you don't give someone a past experience to dig a 10-foot hole, then it can be effective.
Right.
And so the past experiment is the Unified School District.
Mm-hmm.
And this public school system is not alone. This is across the entire system. And the 10-foot hole is the achievement gap.
Mm-hmm.
And the reality is we're losing children in third grade.
Correct.
And so, to look at the statistics, can we see in Las Vegas Unified School District, nearly 70% of ninth graders that are below proficiency in math and English. And many are reading at third grade level. And so ninth grade, when you only have 4 years to matriculate out of high school and into the college environment, it's almost impossible in a broken system to catch those children. So what we're finding, particularly with African American and Latino boys, is a dropout rate of 50%. Which perpetuates poverty in the community because if you don't have high school education at the minimum, you have unemployment, underemployment, there's then the entry into the gang culture, crime, drugs, and then it permeates right into the prison industrial complex. So when you look at the prison industrial complex, more than 70% of the inmate population have a third grade reading comprehension level. So there's a direct correlation between education, the field of education, and incarceration.
And I've talked to the students in other classes and other political science classes about the tracking of the third graders. When you get to the third grade, you already know that you have a cell waiting for you.
They determine how many beds to build in the prison industrial complex.
Right.
This is becoming prioritized, which is interesting.
Yeah.
But the prison industrial complex is determining how many beds to build based on the rating comprehension level of third
graders. True. Do you agree then with NAACP's Ben Salas' recent assessment that education is becoming the next civil rights major issue of our time?
Absolutely, but it is becoming. It's not an emergency, it is.
Right.
But this problem has been going on 30 years.
Yes.
This is not a recent problem.
Right.
And we're using an integrated system of public education. We call it the industrial era, where you were training students to be workers in factories. And the world has changed, and the public system did not. So public education system did not change to prepare our society for the technological skill set that is needed for workers.
That's why we're not competitive against those other countries where we didn't have that. And where the focus has been, the change has occurred, but we haven't done so yet. And so
it's not happening in our industry school.
Right, okay, true. And it's not. And to that extent, how do you see that? How do you see the reform occurring? We've got to go back. Well, we should be moving forward, but moving forward, how do you see that vision of bringing kids up? There's not a lot of years to capture. And you can't go backwards. So moving forward, where do we go with it?
Well, you know, I think we have to look at the classroom environment. And one of the biggest challenges is whether or not the teachers are able to connect with their students. Every child has the capacity to learn and achieve at a high level. But if you're not able to connect with that child, then you're losing the first battleground of educating the child properly. And when you look at Los Angeles Unified School District, it's comprised of 80% of the teachers, 10% of African Americans, and then 10% other. And then the teaching core being about 70% white, voting, there's a disconnect. There has to be, I think, a lot of cultural sensitivity training, culturally responsive pedagogy and teaching for our classrooms, and it has to be a culturally relevant curriculum. Mm-hmm. Because to speak to a African American Latino child who both have their unique cultural identities about a mainstream, or I'm using the term loosely, but a white cultural a practice or identity, there's a disconnect to begin with. And so, I don't love asparagus, but to teach a young black child about asparagus when all they had was collard greens, there's going to be a disconnect.
Right, right.
And that's a simplified analogy, but we need to look at the curriculum and the teaching methods as being closely related.
Okay.
That's the first thing.
Okay. One of the questions that I had for you was, has SELC teamed up with programs like Teach for AmeriCorps, who are working diligently and strategically in hundreds of underrepresented communities to increase student achievement in an effort to shrink the enormous inequality, that big gap that we factually know exists in these communities, and if so, how?
I work with Teach for America, Ty Miller, the executive director,
right.
And it's around the issues of cultural sensitivity treatment, and they are a wonderful organization. They have the capacity to train as many teachers as we need to go into the city schools. But Teach for America is designed to pipeline teachers into the schools that have the most need. But one of the challenges is to go into the school system where there's not enough support for the teachers. It's a burnout curse. There's not enough teacher development that takes place. And one of the problems that we're finding is the distribution of resources in the public school system is not designed to have the money follow the child to go into the classroom at its fullest potential. And it's going to change, a systemic change that has to take place. Because in the Los Angeles Unified School District, I would imagine most school districts across the country, in traditional public schools, about 40% of the money that is generated from the child going to school, all the school attendance or EDA, is directed towards bureaucracy.
Right. Administration.
Administration. About 60% go into the And so we're already in a budget crisis where they're taking more than $1 billion away from public education in California. We're going to go from being eighth in financing child's education to somewhere around 38th to not allocate the funds to the classroom to as full as it is so that the teachers can have the capability to teach them what they need to. Is shooting itself enough. We'll never be able to fix this problem unless we we fix the funding formulas. Right now we operate on a district funding formula where the money will come in to ADA average daily attendance. It's based on the number of children at the school. I'm already getting the deferral dollars, Title 1, Title 2, Title 3, 4, for special needs. But the money will pass through the school and go into a district
library.
And the district, they redistribute the funds not based on the children's needs, but based on the expenses of the school. Now, herein lies the institutional discrimination. If you take a school in the inner city with 1,000 students, and 10 teachers, and a school in the suburban area with 1,000 students and 10 teachers, and they both generate $1 million in revenue. The inner city school, the average teaching experience of teachers is about 2 years. We have a disproportionate amount of versus senior teachers. Now, I love those teachers because they know what they want to be. They're committed to helping these children. But they're only salary at $40,000 a year.
Right.
So with 10 teachers, this is the aggregate salary of the inner city school is $400,000. So the district, even though they generate $1 million, the district will see $400,000.
Right.
That school in the suburban area has teachers that have 18, 15, 20 years experience. They have master's degrees, doctors, and they're making $80,000 a year. Aggregate salary of $800,000. So you generate $1 million and $800,000 goes back to home. Now, if we multiply or replicate that model, that formula across the district, then you can see that the lower level, the inner city schools are subsidizing the suburban schools through that funding formula. And the problem we have is that because of the broken system and the lack of resources, because the administrator of the school in the inner city, they have $600,000 which can go to different development, which can go to school cases, because sometimes 40% of the children are from foster care.
Right, they need the counseling.
They need the counseling. They need the books, they need computers.
Right.
But it doesn't stay there. And so, because of the resource strain, the turnover rate of teachers in the inner city is about 60%. So, there's no stability in the educational environment. But the inherent institutional discrimination is that this lower quality education, not because of the teachers, but because of the environment that the teachers teach, is actually subsidizing a better quality education than the suburban area. You see that by documentary, who is accountable?
And we need to go back and fix that formula all the way around. It even applies to higher education.
It applies to higher education.
At this school, we have a commuter student population. But our FTE for funding is based on full-time equivalents, so it takes two to make up for one here. We never get the amount of money that Stanislaus or San Luis Obispo or even Chico State, or even Fullerton across the freeway down here. We don't get the kind of funds that we should.
But it's not the students
to do the same results.
Yeah. So, you know, this has to change if we're going to fix the problem of public education. If you remember in 2006, UCLA in their freshman class of about 5,000 students admitted only 96 African Americans in freshman class of over 5,000. How many of those 96 were scholar athletes? So 76 students gained entrance based on academics. And the claim was they can't find academically qualified students. Now, of course, the civil rights activists, I felt that too, if you can find them, run up and down the track, or the basketball court, or football field, or whatever it may be, then you can find them academically qualified throughout this nation. And you can force them to change their admittance policy to be more holistic, like UC Berkeley's, which I'm an alumni of, and I've heard that. And to take into consideration more than the SAT, more than the SAT and the grade point average. Now, again, we see an inherently discriminatory system in just how that students are evaluated. It's solely or focused on SAT and grade point average. In many of the city schools, we have teachers that have 2-3 years experience, or have teachers that have been non-performing that are transferred into the inner city schools. The ability to teach in fast placement courses, which gives an artificial bump in their grade point average. is minimal. And so you're looking at the story coming out of Crenshaw or Dorsey with a 4.0 grade point. Going through neighborhoods where they had to deal with drugs. Sometimes in lower income families where they may not have a job, and they're still pulling a high grade point average. But if you compare that student with a 4.0 grade point average to one who's in Paul State, that was 4.5 or a 5.0 because of the advanced placement courses, we lose every time. Now, from the high school that you were talking about earlier, we're supposed to know that. But if you talk to our mind, the last civil rights legislation in Wisconsin and California, the last civil rights legislation just reversed the gains that we had. It creates this disparity in quality of education and opportunity to a high quality education. And so you also have the SAT scores, and it's not because you're not passing, but obviously, but the SAT scores, you have the courses, the test preparation that are available in policies that prepare a student to score very high. And a lot of times, because of the cost of those programs, it makes it prohibitive for many students and actually to engage in those classes. But there's, it wasn't enough for me to say, to protest the disparity in the quality of education as a teaching gap without understanding how it's facilitated and maintained. And those are just a couple of ways that we see that this discrimination is continuing to be maintained, in the achievement gap before we maintain in our school system.
Right. Rubensia, student Rubensia says, LA Unified School District magnet acceptance ratio for whites is 30%. How could that be when whites represent less than 30% of the district? This is an example of what you are saying.
Well, I think what you're reference to is that of the students that apply to the magnet schools, 30% of them are white.
Right.
And so, which shows a huge disparity when 90% of the student population is children of color. You have a problem with the magnet program because what you have is a general school population, and within the general school population, a civil group of students where the teachers, the best teachers, most African teachers, are able to teach with the flexibility of how to teach and what to teach in terms of the curriculum. And so, it's a simple question within the school system. And so for the people who have the knowledge of how to manipulate the system and get their children into the main program, that's in the general population, you get a higher quality education than your general school population. And what happens is it's an artificial bump in terms of the school's academic performance index because you have a group of students that are not performing everybody else, but artificially deals with the general school population.
Right. It's our system, though.
It's our system that needs to be reformed.
It looks like we have 1 minute, and I had a ton of questions to ask you. That's okay, because we got through quite a few of them. But with 1 minute left, what are your thoughts about Mrs. Parrish Thomas calling Miss Anita Hill this past week, asking for an apology for what happened?
I have no idea why she did that. That was.
She
came out of left field. And I don't know what her objective was, except maybe she's still wounded by it.
Yeah.
And 19 years later, it's been too long. Still wounded by it and wanting to leave.
All right,
10
seconds left.